Owain Glyndwr was born to a powerful Anglo-Welsh family. His father, Gruffydd Fychan, was able to date his lineage back to before the days of the Norman Conquest. His mother, Elen Ferch, was also of nobility. Now, Owain was born around the time when there was relative peace between England and Wales, which was a stark contrast to the centuries prior. You can check that out in this video here, where we talk about the history of the Welsh warriors in the days of Henry II and kings like him. Now, even though there was peace between them at this time, that does not mean that the Welsh were not under suppression. As a matter of fact, they were not only under suppression and jurisdiction, but they had certain restrictions on their life. They could not own land within 10 miles of any town. They had to pay specific taxes that were put only on Welshmen that Englishmen didn't have to pay. They were not allowed to bear arms unless they had sworn loyalty and allegiance to the King of England. And there were also restrictions on how much mead they were allowed to brew and how much beer they were allowed to brew. Things like that. So they were under a form of suppression. It was also around this time that Wales had a burning desire for their own independence. However, Owain was not a man who was necessarily born or even brought up to become the leader of the rebellion that he would eventually do so. Now, back to Owain. Now, Owain's father died when he was around 10 years old, and he was brought up as the protege of Sir David Hamner, whose profession was a judge. Owain followed in Hamner's footsteps and went to study law at the Inns of Court. However, he did not become a man of law. He married Defyd's daughter in 1383, which added titles and lands to him. I cannot pronounce them, so I'm just going to put them right here to his title. In 1384, he enlisted under Sir Gregory of the Marches area, which was the border between England and Wales. In 1385, he enlisted under Earl of Arundel, fighting for Richard II, who at the time was King of England. So basically, until the last decade of the 1300s, Owain was a man of the march, and he was the epitome of an assimilated man. He wasn't a man who the King of England or any of the nobles would suspect of leading a rebellion against England, even having the desire to do so. He had already fought for the King of England when he enlisted under the Earl of Arundel, so he was not someone who was basically being prepared or christened for a rebel leader. Now, in 1399, things changed when Henry IV seized power from Richard II, his cousin, who he wound up starving to death. Story for a different day. So the immediate spark for Owain's rebellion against the King of England did not come necessarily for a sense of independence of Wales. Instead, it came over a land dispute between himself and another Englishman. That man was Reginald de Grey of the Ruthen Marcher Lordship. Long story short, Grey had seized some of Owain's lands. Owain actually wrote a letter to the king in appeal asking him to do something on his behalf on the seizure of his lands, and the king did nothing. Grey went further to even send a letter to Owain telling him that he would burn all of his lands and do with him as he pleased. Owain once again appealed to the king, and the king still did nothing. Owain then said he would retaliate against Grey for stealing his lands by terms of force, you know, any means necessary, basically. Reginald de Grey then sent a letter to the king denouncing him as a traitor. So, you know, Owain was in a no-win situation here. He tried appealing to help for the king did nothing, and so when he said he would retaliate, Grey used that as an excuse to tell the king, this man's a traitor. On September 16th, 1400, Owain actually initiated a full-on rebellion against the king, and he was given the title Prince of Wales at this place. Now, this was a noted act of defiance against the King of England, because for the last 100 years, the title Prince of Wales had been reserved for the eldest son of the King of England. So Owain was sending a message directly to Henry, letting him know not only was he not his king, but he was also in defiance of the laws the king had had in Wales since the 1283, when Edward I, King of England, had thoroughly subjugated the Welsh. The Welshman's first target was Ruthen of the North. Now, the reason he took this place was because it was the home of Reginald de Grey, the man who had stolen his property from him, and also it had many English settlers. So with 250 men, on September 18th, 1400, Owain snuck in there and attacked the town, burning nearly every building inside of it. There were only 3 buildings left standing after the rampage went on, and one of those was the castle itself. Owain would go on to attack Denbigh, Flint, Holt, Welshpool, and other towns before Henry was able to take military action against him. Henry invaded the country and tried to force Owain into pitched battle, but there were 2 big problems for Henry. One was the landscape. Even though Henry had men with superior weaponry, superior supplies, and superior armor, he had to move into the Welsh and their homeland. Now, remember, the castles inside of Wales were built to keep the Welsh in. They were not designed for open conflict. You can't move a castle around. So if you wanted to defeat the Welsh, you had to bring them into open battle and wipe them out. But Wales is a country full of many hills, mountains, and there were several places for Owain to hide. So Henry marched his army up and tried to force Owain into battle. Owain, of course, wisely refused giving battle on the open field to Henry, much like his ancestor did when Henry II invaded England several centuries prior. The other problem for Henry was that Owain was not a fool. Remember, he had served as a man of arms. He was a soldier underneath the king, Richard II, since the 1380s. So he knew how Henry would fight. He knew how his army would move. He knew what supplies they would have. He also knew their approach to battle. And all he had to do was not give in to it. You know, in order for Henry to have a decisive victory, Owain would have to play into his hand and fight him on his terms. Owain was refusing to fight him on his terms, giving Henry another big problem. So, using guerrilla tactics, Owain continued to harass and ambush bits and pieces of Henry's army. And in 1401, at Hidgin, he actually ambushed the entire royal army, inflicting defeat upon them. Owain also opened negotiations with the Scots and other Englishmen who had been disaffected by the new Lancastrian regime. Remember, Henry did not become king because he was the heir to the throne. Henry became king by killing Richard II and seizing his crown. So many of Henry's current subjects did not like his position on the throne, and Owain was willing to use them to his advantage. The Scots, who were the hereditary enemies of the English, much like the Welsh themselves, also had no love for Henry. So he was trying to build himself allies. In 1402, Henry tried once again to put a swift end to the rebellion, which would result in the greatest victory of Owain's rebellion.